So she's met some street thieves who are, they steal really strange things and won't tell her why they're stealing them. Their names are Teddy and Zap. And tonight she's out with Zap. She goes out disguised as a boy, and Teddy and Zap know she's not a boy, but they don't know that she's a queen. And they give her the nicknames Sparks for reasons I won't get into, but that's what Zap calls her. On the counters and tables of this story room, pots and buckets pinged with a tinny rhythm of falling drops. Bitterblue shot a dubious glance at the ceiling and kept to the edges of the room. The favor was a squat woman with a deep, melodious voice. The story was one of Lex's old animal tales, a boy in a boat on a frozen river, a fuchsia bird of prey with silver claws like anchor hooks, a gorgeous, mesmerizing, vicious creature. Bitterblue hated the story. She remembered Lex telling it to her, or one very similar. She could almost see Lex right there on the bar, one eye covered, the other gray, keen, and careful. An image flickered then and flashed bright, the terrible wreck of the eye behind Lex's eye patch. "Come on, let's go," Zap was saying. "Sparks, I'm done here, let's go." Bitterblue didn't hear him. Lex had removed the patch for her just once, laughing, saying something about a horse that had reared and kicked him. She had seen the globe of his eyeball swollen purple with blood and had thought that the vivid crimson of the pupil was a blood stain, not a clue to the truth of everything, a clue that explained why she felt so plodding and stupid and forgetful so much of the time, especially every time she sat with him, wanting to show off how well she read, hoping to please him. Zap took hold of her wrist and tried to tug her away. Suddenly she was awake, galvanized. She swung out at him, but he grabbed that wrist too, held her in a double grip, and muttered low, "Sparks, don't fight me here. Wait till we're outside. Let's go." When had the room gotten so crowded and hot? A man sidling too close to her said in a voice too smooth, "Is this golden fellow giving you a hard time, boy? Do you need a friend?" Zap spun on the man with a growl. The man backed away, hands raised, eyebrows raised, conceding defeat, and now it was Bitterblue grabbing onto Zap as Zap pushed after the man. Bitterblue grasping Zap's injured arm intentionally to cause him pain, to turn his fury back onto her, whom she knew he would not hurt, and away from everyone else in the room, whom she was less certain about. "None of that," she said. "Let's go." Zap was gasping. Tears brightened his eyes. She'd hurt him more than she meant to, but perhaps not more than she needed to. And anyway, it didn't matter, because they were leaving now, pushing through the people and scrambling out into the rain. Outside, Zap ran, turned into an alleyway, and crouched low under the shelter of the awning. Bitterblue followed him and stood above him as he cradled his arm to his chest, swearing what he heard. "I'm sorry," she said when he finally seemed to be switching from words to deep breaths. "Sparks," a few more deep breaths. "What happened in there? I lost you. You weren't hearing a word I said." "Teddy was right," she said. "It helped you to have me to look after. And I was right, too. You needed someone to look after you." Then she heard her own words and shook her head to clear it. "I really am sorry, Zap. I was somewhere else. That story transported me." "Well," Zap said, standing carefully, "I'll show you something that'll bring you back." "You had time to steal something," she asked. "Sparks," he said. "It only takes a moment." He pulled a gold disc from his coat pocket and held it under a guttering street lamp. When he flicked the disc open, she took the edge of his hand, adjusting the angle so that she could see what she thought she saw. A large pocket watch with a face that had not 12, but 15 hours, and not 60, but 50 minutes. "Feel like explaining this to me," she asked. "Oh," he said, "it was one of Lex's games. He had an artist who was brilliant with small mechanics and liked to tinker with timepieces. Lex got her made pocket watches that divided the half day into 15 hours, but ran through them more quickly to make up the difference. Apparently, he liked to have all the people around him talking gibberish about the time and believing their own gibberish. It's 14:30, Lord King, would you like your lunch?" That sort of thing. How creepy that this should sound familiar, as he said. Not a memory, not anything specific. Just a feeling that she'd always known pocket watches like these, but hadn't thought them worth considering for the past 8 years. He had a perverted sense of humor, she said. "They're popular now in certain circles, worth a small fortune," Sass said quietly, "but considered to be stolen property. Lex compelled the woman to build them without compensating her. Then presumably he murdered her, as he did most of his artists, and hoarded the watches for himself. They made their way to the black market once he died." "Do they keep good time?" she asked. "Yes," he said, "but out real time. Yes, Bitterblue said. I suppose you could convert everything into minutes. 12 times 60 is 720, and 15 times 50 is 750. So our 720-minute half-day equals its 750-minute half-day. Let's see. Right now, the watch reads a time of nearly 25 past 2. That's 125 total minutes, which, divided by 750, should equal our time in minutes divided by 720. So 720 times 125 is, give me a moment, 90,000 divided by 750 is 120, which means, well, the numbers are quite neat, aren't they? It's just about 2 o'clock. I should go home. Sat had begun to chuckle, partly through this litany, when, right on cue, a distant clock tower chimed twice. He burst into laughter. I, for one, would find it simpler to memorize which time state class was. Naturally, Sass said, still chuckling. What's so funny? I should know by now not to be surprised by anything you say or do, shouldn't I, Sparks? His voice had gone gentle somehow, teasing. They stood close, heads bent together over the watch, her fingers still holding his hand. She understood something suddenly, not with her mind, but in the air that touched her throat and made her shiver when she looked up into his bruised face. Ah, she said, good night, Sarah. And then she slipped away. Nothing had happened. Still, the next day, she couldn't stop thinking about it. Astonishing how much thought could be generated about nothing. He came upon her at the most inconvenient moments, so that she was certain everyone who looked into her eyes knew exactly what she was thinking about. It was a good thing, really, that the council meeting was planned for that night. She needed to cool down before she went out again. Katsa burst into her rooms far too early. Ho tells me you need sword practice, she said, then committed an outrage by pulling Bitterblue's cheeks away. I don't even have a sword yet, Bitterblue moaned, trying to burrow back under. They're making it.